Before we move on to the rest of the combinational circuit building blocks like decoders, encoders, and priority encoders, I want to mention a few comments about the use of conditional statements, which are sometimes called conditional control constructs. And these are the if, else, the case statements, and even the condition operator, which is the question mark and a colon. So these construct or conditional control constructs appear in C. However, the way you use them in C does not reflect how they get interpreted in Verilog. So in C, everything is executed sequentially. When you have a bunch of control constructs, like if-else statements, you're basically sequentially asking these questions, like one at a time. However, if you're thinking about Verilog, whenever you write something in Verilog, it gets interpreted into hardware. And hardware does not operate sequentially. What it does is every piece of hardware on the board or on the FPGA works at the same time. So everything is happening concurrently. So as it turns out, whenever you use conditional control constructs, whenever you use the if statements or case statements or the condition operator, they get interpreted or they get realized by what we call routing network. And there's a couple of routing networks available in general. So there's a priority routing network, and you generally see it whenever you use the if-else statements or what we call non-parallel case. For now, let's focus on the if-else statement in here. And the other routing network available to us is what we call a multiplexing network, okay? And usually you see it with a parallel case. For now, let's think about it, the case, and I'll tell you the difference between parallel and non-parallel cases with an example. Well, why don't I just explain these two routing networks with an example that we've seen before? So I'm now in Verilog, or in Vivado, and I have written, or I'm showing you the multiplexer, the 4-to-1 multiplexer that we have developed before. And I've showed you a few ways to actually implement this 4-to-1 multiplexer. One incorporated the use of an if-else statement, and the other one used the case statement. So let's start with the if-else statement. Based on these slides, this should be interpreted or realized as a priority routing network. What do I mean by that? What I mean is, whenever you actually write code, behavioral code that is within the always statement, and you use the if-else statement, Vivado or whatever CAD tool you're using will take that code and try to interpret it. And it interprets it as a priority routing network, which means that it interprets it as a sequence of 2-to-1 multiplexers connected in cascade. So let me show you. So we're gonna go to the schematic in here and let's see it. Hopefully we'll get 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 multiplexers in cascade, one after the other, maybe less, maybe 4. Okay, well, it's interpreted in 3. That's fine. I think it found a better way to do it. But anyway, what I'm trying to say in here is, like, you don't need 5, you need only 3. So this one in here is that multiplexer. So let me show you the code. Let me just expand this in here. Let me just write that down or put it down in here so that we get to see it. So here's the code. And in this code, what I have is I have an if statement, an else if, an else if, an else if, and an else in here. And what happened is this multiplexer in here, it's connected to a multiplexer before it, which is connected to a multiplexer before it. And we call it priority routing network because this multiplexer here has the highest priority. It actually gets, like, if you think about it, if this selector here select this guy in here, I don't care what's happening in here. However, they're all running concurrently. That's what I meant by code in Verilog does not operate sequentially. Everything is concurrently. This multiplexer, they're all running at the same time. However, based on whatever we put on the selector, something gets routed out, okay? This has the highest priority, and that's why we call this priority routing network. Let's see, what is it actually showing me? This is actually the W0, and it has the highest priority. And let's take a look at the code. And in the code, this is actually the first question I'm asking. I'm asking, is S equals 0? And that's what you see in here. Is it 2-bit 0, 0? If that's the case, I'm just going to route it out. If that's not the case, I'll actually see the other one, which is coming from here, which is the output of the next one. And this is this if-else statement in here. And you get the idea. The same goes in here. This is basically the next highest priority, which is the W1, and then the W2, and then the W3 here. And we only needed one multiplexer for these, and that's why. Now, you probably do not see this one because the Vivado did not see a need to actually output an XX. Generally speaking, it's included, and you'll see now, or I'm going to show you next, why we usually include these else statements. It's good habit to always include an else statement, just in case you forgot one of the cases. Maybe the S, you didn't account for one of them. Okay. Now, if I actually am to switch the order of these if statements, remember, like in Vivado, whenever we wrote something or statements or continuous statement, the order did not matter. However, I told you, whenever you're within the always statement, at least up to this point where we're actually dealing with combinational circuits, this order actually does matter. the priority of your signal will actually change. So let's assume that instead of writing this particular if statement, I'm actually going to do another if statement, which is here. So S, instead of that, I'm just gonna say, okay, if S equals equals now 2-bit, okay, 2-binary, and let's say 1-1, and I wanted this to be F equals W3, okay? And now I can technically just get the rest of the signals almost the same. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna copy paste these in here, and just to show you why do we call it priority routing network, okay? So we have this here, okay, sorry about that. Okay, so we do that here, and then, okay, so we have W3, I believe this, I'm just gonna change it, I believe this should be 00, and I'll do this as a W0 in here, and of course, what I'm gonna do is I will just remove these here or just make them commented, okay? So that's fine, and just to keep with a good habit of just writing with an else statement, so what I'm gonna say is F equals some binary X in here. Okay, so I think I accounted for all the cases, the 0, 1, 2, and 3, and something with the else. So now I'm going to do that. I saved it. I'm just going to reload, and I'm going to show you. Now the highest priority one would be the W3, because this is the first question I'm asking. Again, this is hardware. It's not being implemented in sequential, okay? It's being implemented in hardware. And as you see, this multiplexer now has W3 as the highest priority. What I'm trying to tell you in here is, it is okay to write behavioral code in Verilog, and actually this is part of the language, so you should be comfortable using it. However, you should be able to interpret or to anticipate what type of hardware you're gonna get. So in here, I figured out that because I'm using the if-else and else-if statements and all of these, I'm getting a priority routing network, which is just a bunch of multiplexer connected in cascade. However, if for some reason or another speed is important to me and I have an if-else statement which I have seen before, I have a bunch of them, let's say 20 or 30, that means I have, for sake of simplicity, I have 20 of these cascading signals. So sometimes that W0 will take a long time and it might create a delay to appear at the output because it has to go through all these multiplexers. So it might generate or might create some unintended propagation delays. If we're dealing with speeds and high frequency circuits or something like that, that will be important. So it might not be the best way to write it with an if-else statement. Okay, so that's what priority routing network is. So what about multiplexing network? Okay, so a multiplexing network is generally speaking, as you can see here in the slides, is with parallel cases. Okay, let's talk about it as if it's cases for now, and I'll tell you what parallel case is. Okay, so I'm gonna do this here. All right, and now it's the same code. It has the same functionality. However, it's gonna interpret it as completely different circuits. So I'm gonna save it in here and I'm gonna show you. So a multiplexing network, as it turns out, instead of interpreting my circuit or my code as a sequence of 2-to-1 multiplexer, we'll just interpret it as a big multiplexer with a bunch of inputs. And that's exactly what we have in here. So I was trying to do a 4-to-1 multiplexer and it did interpret it as a big multiplexer. So in here, because I'm implementing a multiplexer, this seems to be the better solution in here in terms of delays or anything that's the case. However, functionality-wise, it is the same. Okay, so priority routing network is a bunch of cascading 2-to-1 multiplexers. A multiplexing network is just a big multiplexer that has many, many inputs and one output. The bottom line in here is whenever you write code in Verilog, okay, whenever you write code in Verilog, make sure that you understand what type of hardware it will be interpreted to. If you use if-else statement, think about cascading 2-to-1 multiplexers. If you're using case statement, think about a big multiplexer. That's how we're doing. Okay, when should you use one over the other? Well, there isn't a correct answer or like a definite answer. However, generally speaking, if you have some priority within your circuit, which we were gonna see, for example, a priority encoder has the word priority in it, chances are it's better to use if-else statement. And if something else that you need a multiplexing routing network, generally speaking, it's something that you're implementing a big truth table or something. We'll see it with a 7-segment decoder, for example. Okay, so these are the two routing networks if you're using conditioning, okay? I believe we have seen another way, or let me just show you. So we have seen one with a generic here. Let me just show you. So we use a multiplexer that is generic in here, and let's try to interpret. I'm just gonna close this guy in here. I'm gonna do this here. And let's try to interpret this type of code in here, which is that, okay? It's a multiplexer, it's the generic. It's the one that has many inputs, and I put 6 in here, for example, but they're all 1-bit. Okay, so take a look at this code in here. What I have is I have a couple of things. I have an always statement, so this is behavioral. It's describing a behavioral. I described it as how I interpret this to be, but we have to anticipate that there will be hardware that will be outputted from this. What type of hardware? Well, let's see. It's a for loop, and inside the for loop, there's an if statement. Well, an if statement is a priority routing network. So generally speaking, or I think it will interpret it as a bunch of 2-to-1 multiplexers, depending on how many times I iterate within that for loop. So let's see that. I will actually make this my top file in here. Okay, we'll wait a second in here till it gets, till finish updating. And then I'm gonna go to the schematics in here and I'm gonna say, okay, show me. And by default, I set my input to 6. Okay, so I'm assuming I will get maybe 6 or 5 of these 2-to-1 multiplexers. Let's see. Okay, so don't mind the error. Okay, so there you go, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Yes, that's basically how it interpreted it to. Now, if I have it more, for example, and instead of the default, I put 16, that will be a really large number. So I'm gonna just reload that, and hopefully the schematic will show me maybe 15 of these multiplexers or so. You can count them. Just the point is, they're gonna be a lot of them. And of course, the delay or the propagation delay that from the beginning to the end might be really large. And as you can see, it's just interpreted as a 2-to-1 multiplexer. The bottom line again is you are writing hardware in here. This code is hardware description language. It's not C, nothing is getting sequential. Everything gets interpreted into hardware. All right, so before I move on, I just want to give you a couple of comments in here that I've seen, okay? So generally speaking, okay, we figured out priority routing network, multiplex and routing network and so forth. Okay, what type of errors can I get if I don't have everything or if I write always statement or code? Okay, well, as it turns out in combinational circuits, an output, for example, in this case, which is the 4-to-1 multiplexer again, the output is only a function of the current inputs. Okay, so it's a function of W0, W1, W2, W3, and S. There's no internal state whatsoever, which means that there is no storage element and there shouldn't be a storage element there. Okay, that's how a combinational circuit. So if you're writing a module that describes a combinational circuit, you should make sure that the output doesn't have any storage element whatsoever. Okay, so I'm gonna show you right now a few examples in here or an example, and I'm gonna explain to you what's the always statement doing. So let's assume for some reason or another, you actually did the following. You said, okay, I'm not gonna include the default. And what I'm gonna do is for some reason or another, I just forgot to specify that one, that case in here, which is the K012, which is the W2, okay? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna save it, okay? And I'm gonna show you what's going to happen. First of all, I'm gonna make it my top file in here again. I believe this is the 4-to-1 multiplexer. We do this here. We make it our top file. And now once it gets updated, okay, now we reload that in here and now we can get the schematic. And what you will see in the schematic is I will get a storage element, specifically a latch. So let's see that latch in here. And I did get a latch. But why did I get a latch? A latch, if you might remember, it's similar to flip-flop. It's just not as sequential or not as synchronous as a flip-flop. It's just a storage element for now. Okay, we'll talk about it in a separate module. But what I'm trying to get in here is the following. I have an output, I have inputs, and I have a latch. That means it depends on some sort of a previous value. And of course, because I removed that W2, it just doesn't seem to appear. I mean, it's an error in my code. Sometimes you might write really large code, okay, and it seems to be correct, but it's not correct and it's actually implementing a latch. So why did it implement a latch? So let me explain it. So in here, in the slide, I'm telling you, an always statement, okay, in an always statement, variable will keep its previous value, if not assign a new value. So let me explain. So it's happening in here. Let me just delete all of these here. We don't need them for now, okay? So in here, what I have is I said, okay, this is an always statement. An always statement is not continuously running. It only runs if one of these variables change or whatever is in its sensitivity is change. What I'm saying is if W0, W1, W2, W3, or S change. Let's assume that everything is stable except W2. W2 changed, and that's the thing I just removed, okay? So W change got changed. We got into the always statement in here, okay? And the always statement executed. By the end of the always statement, I did not change the value of F, or I didn't specify what F should be. So what the always statement does, it will actually go and say, okay, what was the last value I've seen for F? I'm just going to keep it. And that question in here, what was the last value of F? And I'm going to keep it, means memory. That means I have to memorize what type of variable I have or what's the value of f. So what I'm saying in here, variable will keep its previous value if not assigned a new value. This is what I mean by that. And that's why we got the latch. Okay, a latch got inferred just because f is like, I executed this and I didn't change it and I didn't know what should f be. Well, it's just gonna revert to the previous value and the previous value is memory. So the following are some guidelines so that you avoid getting latches in your combinational circuits in general. Okay, so if you're writing combinational circuits and you're using if or case statements or something like that, and you abide by these rules and here in front of you, you probably will get a better outcome or a better, like it will infer something you actually mean. So in here, I wrote a code, eventually I wanted basically a big multiplexer, but I didn't get a built-in big multiplexer. I got a couple of multiplexer and latch. This isn't what I wanted. I wanted something different. Okay, so how do we solve it? Well, the easiest solution, for example, is I am not going to fix it as supposed to be, like, for example, the 0, 1, and 2. For example, the easiest solution in here, which is the first one here, make sure that all branches of the if and the case statements are included. So if you're using if, use else, okay, at the very end, not else if, like else. That captures every other case that you didn't account for. And if you're using case, just use default, okay, which capture anything that you didn't account for. For example, in here, I'm going to say default, okay, and I'm just going to say, okay, by default, I'm going to say f equals something like, for example, an x, okay, or a binary x. All right, so what I did at this point, I said, okay, if you execute and it didn't match any of these, okay, just go to the default and attach something to f or assign something to f, and I can do whatever I want, like x's, zeros, whatever you can imagine. So I'm just going to reload this to see what will happen. Okay, hopefully it will actually fix that latch and that latch will disappear because I have a value of f in every single time I actually run something. And it did disappear. So as you can see, w2 is still not fixed, okay? And I don't have a latch because I fixed it. Now I counted for every value. Like that always statement does not need to remember what the value of f is. Okay, so that's one way to solve that solution. One way to solve it. So what do you get out of this? If you're writing a case statement, make sure you include a default, even though if you don't need it, even though like you might think that you accounted for everything, maybe by mistake you did not. Just use the default, okay? That's just a coding style that I use. And if you're using an if statement, just use else at the very end. Like for example, we had a bunch of if statements in here, for example, if, and then if else, okay? Just use an else in here and fill it with something. Good. So this is the first coding style or the coding recommendation or the coding style recommendation, okay? The next one in here, it's telling me, make sure that all outputs are assigned in all branches. Meaning, if you do not have, let's assume that I have another output, for some reason or another, I'm gonna just say F and maybe M, okay? And let's assume that you wanted to assign f something, and then at the same time, of course, because we're doing this, we're going to have to do a begin and an end or something like that. Okay, well, why don't I just do this here? We're going to do a begin and an end. Okay, and here I'm going to do an end, and I will use, and I'm going to tell you that what I'm going to do is I'm going to just say m equals some value, let's say some binary zero. Okay, something like that. I just wanted zero in m. All right, so what did I do in here? What I did is the following. First, I defined a new variable in here, and let's take a look at what's happening in here. What happened is the following. So I have a case statement, okay? It gets executed whenever W0, W1, W2, or W3, or S change. So let's assume something changed. So it'll go and execute this here. It will actually try to figure out if I, well, for some reason or another, I missed one of the cases of the S, but anyway, I'm catching it by the default. However, I'll still get a latch if I actually interpret this code. And the reason why is here, M. I'm not assigning M in all of the branches possible in here. So let's assume M here is zero, and the only way I'm going to change it if I actually get M equals zero in here. So if I load that in here, I expect to see a latch. Okay? Hopefully I get a latch, and I did get a latch in here, okay? And that latch is because of the M. Okay, so let me explain again what's happening in here. Yes, I did use the default, but the default only solved one problem, and that problem is I didn't have all the cases available to me. Okay, the other problem is the following. M in here is only changing in here. Let's assume that this gets executed, but it didn't match the 0, 0, it matched the 0, 1. So f got assigned, but then at the very end of the always statement, it's gonna tell me what was the value of m. Well, you didn't assign it a new value, So I'm just going to remember the previous one, which was zero, because this is the only case. But anyway, so how do I solve for this particular problem? Well, here's the thing. Usually, it's like in addition to just using the default and the else, within the always statement at the very beginning, assign every output you expect some sort of a default value. I usually do the following. I say f equals, okay, maybe binary x or some value, some default value. You choose, it doesn't matter. And m equals binary zero, okay? Whatever value you want. I even can put ones if I want to, okay? It doesn't matter. All right, so now every single time an always gets executed, it will the f will take some value and the m will take some value. So if you go through a case statement or an if statement or something like that, and you forgot or you went to a branch like this one here and that branch did not assign anything to m, it will revert to that default value. And generally speaking, you'll see me doing the following, and I have, say, default values. That's what I usually do if I'm writing like code for production or something. So I'm going to just reload this. Hopefully I will not get a latch, or I expect not to get a latch. I expect to get like a big multiplexer in here. That's what I expect to see. Okay, so let's do this in here. So we do that, and we got a couple of multiplexers because we have the M and the F. Okay, each one of them got interpreted as its own multiplexer, but there's no latch. So what's the summary of everything I mentioned in here? We have a couple of routing networks. One is priority routing network, a bunch of cascading multiplexers, and the other one is just a big multiplexer, what we call a multiplexer routing network. But in either cases, whatever you're actually writing, whether it's a priority routing network or multiplexing network, you need to use these two cases in here. Let me just highlight them for you. Use an else statement if you're using if else, or use case default, like the default of the case, the word default for the case, one of the cases, to account for all different branches possible, and also use default values. This default in here, I mean, it's a bad name, but this has nothing to do with the case itself, like the case's default. This is just use some default value, m equals zero, f equals x's, or whatever you want. If you use these two, whenever you use combinational circuits behavior, or describe combinational circuits using behavioral Verilog code or behavioral modeling, you hopefully will avoid using or inferring latches or memory elements.